I'm fighting for my life.
She helped build an empire with a song in the 60s. Now today's stars rally to the cause as Mary Wells fights for her life. This is Entertainment Tonight for Wednesday, September the 5th, 1990.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to Entertainment Tonight. I'm John Tesh.
And I'm Mary Hart. The singer Mary Wells, the song My Guy. In the early 60s, that magic combination helped launch a musical empire called Motown. Mary Wells has now fallen on difficult times, and many of today's pop stars are rallying to her support.
Nothing you could do could make me untrue to my God.
Mary Wells is called the First Lady of Motown. As a black female teenager in the early 60s, she did the impossible. She became a star by giving Motown a number one hit record. Today, Mary Wells is battling the odds again, but the stakes are higher. She's fighting just to survive her current bout with throat cancer.
I agreed to talk because I have cancer. When I first went in the hospital, I stopped breathing. They had to put this trait in temporarily. I'm fighting for my life.
Come on and let's swing. You know you took my...
It's been a life lived mostly on the stage. Mary got noticed by Motown when at age 16 she wrote this tune, Bye Bye Baby. As part of the touring Motown Review of the early 60s, Wells shared the stage with other black acts who would become legends. Among them, a young singer-songwriter named Smokey Robinson. Smokey wrote hits for Mary Wells, songs which reunited her with Robinson on a Motown television special in 1985.
You beat me to the punch. You beat me to
the punch. The reunion meant more, since when she was just 21, Wells left Motown Records for another label. She all but disappeared from the pop scene and from the public eye until the headlines appeared. Wells smoked two packs of cigarettes a day for 30 years. She believes her smoking, plus the country's air pollution, contributed to her cancer.
This is a trait. The other is a diaphragm of where they're going to use the radiation to get rid of my cancer. This is very serious. I think that all the entertainers, everybody in the world should get involved in fighting for this situation. It's terrible. Between cigarettes, the pollution. Look out there, you can't even see any sun anymore. Everybody is fading. You better get it together fast.
As Wells receives her cancer treatment, her health problems are compounded by financial problems. She and her four-year-old daughter were evicted from this Los Angeles area apartment complex. They're now staying in a hotel near her hospital. Wells' plight has not gone unnoticed by a wide circle of entertainer friends. Former Motown artists like Diana Ross and the Temptations have made substantial donations to Mary, as have other artists, including Bruce Springsteen and Rod Stewart. And former Supreme Mary Wilson is coordinating what may be a benefit concert for Wells with the help of Motown founder Berry Gordy. Among those committed are Dionne Warwick and Stevie Wonder.
This is about just helping this woman who, you know, gave a lot of happiness to all of us.
Motown Productions, which mounted a Motown 25th anniversary special, is planning to honor Wells on its 30th anniversary special later this year.
With regard to the illness, of course, that's just something that we all have to pull together and see to.
Mary Wells is, she's one of our institutions, and we can't see an institution fail.
And Wells, for her part, wants her own ordeal to serve as a warning.
I feel that if nothing is done toward this, from me being ill, so everybody say they love me, that our country's gonna go under. They say it's from cigarette smoke. But look at the pollution out there. Our kids probably be walking around with traits in them.
Mary Wells, who is now 47 years old, has begun a 6.5-week program of radiation therapy in Los Angeles. She hopes that the current financial support from other singers will lead to permanent programs to help artists in need.
The movie world is mourning the passing of a name that spelled magic in the 30s. Irene Dunne, actress, singer, and comedian, is dead at the age of 88.
Many the Irene Dunne was one of Hollywood's classiest leading ladies. She was a trained singer, hailing from Kentucky. A chance meeting in an elevator with Broadway producer Florence Ziegfeld led to stage and screen roles in the legendary Showboat.
We could make believe I love you.
Dunne had the rare ability among star actresses of being able to excel in musicals, dramas, and comedies. She threw Hollywood and fans a curve when she was able to leave soap operas behind and star in two mid-30s screwball classics, Theodora Goes Wild and The Awful Truth, the latter a smash hit opposite Cary Grant.
In a half an hour, we'll no longer be Mr. and Mrs.
If you didn't feel the way you do, things wouldn't be the way they are, would they? I mean, things could be the same if things were different.
Dunne received 5 Oscar nominations, but never won. They range from the early talkie epic Cimarron to her memorable Matriarch in I Remember Mama. More than anything, Irene Dunne was a leading lady with regal bearing, usually playing noble but never stuffy, and with acting and singing talents that pleased millions of people until her voluntary retirement in the 1950s. Irene Dunne played important roles off camera as well. She was often a delegate to Republican national conventions and was appointed by President Dwight Eisenhower to replace Eleanor Roosevelt as a special envoy to the United Nations. Now, on our inside story tomorrow, the mysterious demise of a Rolling Stone. Police say Brian Jones drowned, but a new book said it could have been murder.
Yeah, I think they're all still quite fearful of what the consequences might be of what happened that night.
The death of a Rolling Stone, accident or murder? The inside story tomorrow on Entertainment Tonight.
Coming up next, 4 losers come home to mama, but can Mrs. Finelli shape up the boys before their television debut? And later, Arnold Schwarzenegger has shaped his career into a winner, but we'll take you back for a rare glimpse of Arnold in the days he was pumping up his dreams a pound at a time.
The Finelli boys have a problem. They have a date with NBC this Saturday night, but they'll have to ask Mama if they can go out of the house.
It's your mother. She says if you're late for dinner, she's going to kick all of you till you pass out.
The Finelli boys are 4 Italian brothers who move back home with Mama when their lives fall apart.
What's so funny?
The kid. He's dating a woman twice his age, and he's worried Ma's going to be mad he dropped out of college.
Ned Eisenberg, who plays the sensible brother, believes the show's premise is not far-fetched.
Stranger things happen, you know what I mean? Especially in New York, because apartments are very few and very expensive.
I mean, we were always better together than we were on our own.
Yeah, like the monkeys!
Chris Maloney says the show feels just like his real Italian family, but Ann Gilbert, who plays Mama, says she's anything but ethnic.
I've never been to Brooklyn. I've been to Brooklyn across the bridge, a block. That's all. I'm from Minnesota.
Andy Hirsch is the family's baby, while Joe Pantoliano is the older wheeler dealer.
Here, have a Rolex.
I didn't really get all A's.
Don't worry, it isn't really a Rolex.
Pantoliano predicts success because everybody gets along.
Let's hope we feel the same way in 7 years.
After the Finelli boys debut Saturday night, they'll move to their regular time slot next Wednesday night following Unsolved Mysteries.
The new HBO movie, Criminal Justice, is an indictment against an overburdened court system forced to deal out expedience rather than justice. The movie takes a hard look at one defendant's case, a case where justice served is criminal.
I want out of jail. Now.
Forrest Whitaker plays an underprivileged man accused of a brutal stabbing and caught in the wheels of criminal justice. Anthony LaPaglia plays his overworked public defender. And Jennifer Grey is the prosecuting attorney determined to put him away at all costs.
His face was a foot from her, and nothing obstructed her view of him. That man was Jesse Williams.
The jobs that these people do are so tough. They have to, you know, in a way, detach and also not lose their compassion and their humanity.
LaPaglia found his acting job tough, especially trying to act like an authentic part of the legal system.
Make the prosecution carry the burden of proof.
Some of the dialogue is so technically exacting, and because, as you know, I'm not an attorney, so I have to learn to deal with that and learn how to make it sound like it really comes out of my mouth every single day of my life, when in fact it doesn't.
The case detailed in Criminal Justice is by no means unique. Last year in New York City, nearly 45% of criminal cases were disposed of by plea bargains. Less than 1% went to trial.
Over the past dozen years, Shirley Jones and Marty Engels have had their share of trials and tribulations. Now they've put them on paper in a new book with a title that says it all.
Shirley and Marty, an unlikely love story, begins as Shirley was ending a 17-year marriage to Broadway leading man Jack Cassidy. Audiences knew her as the picture-perfect star of musicals, including Oklahoma, The Music Man, and Carousel. Marty Engels was a screwball comedian recovering from a nervous breakdown, afraid to leave his house.
Our first date, one of our first dates, I think it was the second date, he picked me up in a 32-foot motorhome so we wouldn't have to go to a restaurant.
That's right.
Despite the rocky beginning, they married and Marty became the stepfather to Shirley's three sons, Sean, Patrick, and Ryan. The setup led to times of great conflict.
When he would discipline the children, he did it, I never felt there was any love behind it. They went through a lot of, a lot of real back and forth, even knockdown, drag-out fights.
But Shirley says it was Marty's strength that helped her go through an intensely painful experience. She was forced to commit her youngest son to a strict 17-month-long drug rehab program. It cured him and nearly devastated her.
I had my own problems. I cried day and night because they wouldn't allow me to talk to my child or certainly see my child or give him any of my letters.
The couple says these tough times brought them closer together, and Shirley believes this isn't such an unlikely love story when you consider Marty's unfailing sense of humor.
Oh, how about that? Isn't that gorgeous? How about this? Same thing.
Obviously, I need some of that, and he needs my sense of stability, and we give that to each other.
By the way, contrary to popular belief, Shirley Jones is not David Cassidy's mother. She feels badly that his real mom, Evelyn Ward, never got the credit due to her.
Another unlikely romance has perhaps helped Donald Trump's new book, Surviving at the Top, into the number one spot on the New York Times bestseller list. All that publicity with Trump and Marla Maples didn't hurt. Speaking of number ones, Cheers captured the honors in the television ratings race last week, and Ghost has just moved to the top spot for the summer movie season, bringing in over $125 million so far. The name Arnold Schwarzenegger has become synonymous with power and action. Just the name alone can guarantee box office success. But before Arnold became a big star, he had a plan that required brawn as well as brains.
Very dramatic, Arnold.
Mr. Dynamo.
In the 1977 documentary Pumping Iron, a then unknown Arnold Schwarzenegger knew he was headed for greatness.
I love to be the best in the world. Just the best.
Arnold did become the greatest bodybuilder in history, but in a new book written by Pumping Iron director George Butler, conquering iron was just one of his many goals.
He had a very coherent plan for his life. He decided he would become the best bodybuilder in history. He did that. He also decided that the way to power in America is through money, and so he set out to become a millionaire, and he did it.
Arnold always knew bodybuilding would take him to the top.
I couldn't wait to go to the gym. I couldn't wait to do another sit-up, another repetition of bench press or squats or whatever the exercise was, because I knew each poundage that I lifted took me a step closer to this goal. I would like to get into acting and find out if I can be good in that.
In the early days, Arnold had his eye on Hollywood. Today, he's one of the highest paid actors on the big screen, commanding over $10 million a picture. An incredible feat, considering when Butler first screened Pumping Iron to investors, they all thought he was doomed for failure.
At the end of the screening, a very distinguished writer got up and said, George, if you make a film about Arnold Schwarzenegger, you're going to be left off 42nd Street with him.
They brushed off the gloomy reviews and traveled to sunny California to complete the film.
It was wonderful to drive around Santa Monica in those days with Arnold, because we'd come up to a stoplight somewhere and there'd be a UCLA cheerleader in a red Firebird convertible at the stoplight, and Arnold would flex his tricep at her. And it was the most extraordinary thing the woman had ever seen in her life.
Since those early days, Arnold has accomplished all he set out to do.
He took the most difficult means to an end imaginable. he used his muscles to become the great success story in America, and that's a mind blower.
The new book includes 100 photos of Arnold, many unpublished before this, and his personal anecdotes about that rise to fame.
Movies, of course, allow us to explore the deep recesses of the mind, the glories of victory, the passion of love. They also let us visit places and times we'd never get to visit in real life. Leonard Maltin heads the expedition now into this week's video report. Leonard.
Well, John, part of the great appeal of movies is that they can take us anywhere in the world, places we've never been and might never see for ourselves. So this week, a fine film called Mountains of the Moon is coming out in video, and if you missed it in theaters, it's your chance to catch up with a first-rate story about a real-life explorer, Sir Richard Burton, who's just one of the explorers and adventurers to be found on the shelves at your video store.
Don't be offended. It's a blessing.
In Mountains of the Moon, Sir Richard Burton and his party are deep in uncharted African territory, searching for the source of the Nile River. But amidst all the adventure is a personal story of triumph.
It's the lake! It's the lake!
Of course, not every movie adventure is true.
King Solomon's Mines, the Flying Dutchman, Captain Kidd's treasure.
That's Stuart Granger as the fictional hero in King Solomon's Mines, in which he and Richard Carlson venture into darkest Africa on the trail of Deborah Carr's long-lost husband.
What do you say when you meet people in the middle of Africa?
Why, I just say, howdy, pod, how's treats?
Spencer Tracy goes after one of the most famous missing persons in history, in Stanley and Livingston. The story itself is compelling, and Tracy, as usual, is terrific as the New York reporter who stops at nothing to get his man.
Dr. Livingston. I presume.
We've always done things they thought were impossible in the past, and I don't propose to stop now.
No.
And here's Tracy again in one of my favorite films, Northwest Passage. This time he's searching for a trade route to the Pacific, but encounters plenty of danger, including Indians, along the way.
This is not a good way to make war. It is impossible to make war if you are dead. Tell them that.
Northwest Passage is believable and exciting, with a top-notch cast and action to spare. It's a page of American history vividly recreated on film. Four mighty good movies there, two of them with one mighty good actor, Spencer Tracy. And if you haven't seen Mountains of the Moon, the newest of the bunch, I really recommend that one.
Thanks, Leonard.
The Insider butters you up with the real story of the moth and the flame. Won't cost you peanuts, so stay with us.
Air transportation furnished and a promotional fee paid by Delta Airlines. From Europe to the Orient, from Mexico to Canada, Delta can fly you worldwide. At Delta, we love to fly, and it shows.
Celebrating birthdays today, actor Dweezil Zappa is 21. Actress Christian Alfonso is 26. Actor Michael Keaton turns 39 today. Actress Raquel Welch is 50. Actor William Devane, 53. Actress Carol Lawrence is 56. And actor Bob Newhart is 61.
From time to time, the ET Insider comes across strange facts that the world might be just as well off not knowing, the theory being ignorance is bliss. He will now share two of them with you. It turns out there is a scientific reason behind the expression fatal attracted like a moth to a flame. The American Institute of Physics finds that male moths flutter around candles because hot wax smells like female moths, but few live to tell about it. Strange fact number two landed on the Insider's desk from the highly respected and usually authoritative Peanut Advisory Board. They say Americans consume 800 million pounds of peanut butter each year. Going on to point out that's enough to smoothly coat the floor and walls of the Grand Canyon. The Insider shudders to think what would happen to Arizona if male moths thought female moths smelled like peanut butter instead of hot wax.
Paul McCartney paid homage to one of his rock and roll idols last night to salute the upcoming Broadway musical, Buddy, the Buddy Holly Story. In New York, McCartney led an all-star tribute to Holly as Buddy's fans and family reminisced.
I always say where Buddy's music is, he's there, and I know he's here tonight.
For Paul, it was a chance to sing some of his favorite music.
It was great. We had a ball.
In Hollywood, rehearsals for Thursday's MTV Awards were in full swing as rockers like Motley Crue prepared for the live worldwide event.
It's real, real important. You know, this is the 90s. It's the video age, and these are the video awards.
And Todd Bridges, recently acquitted of criminal charges, was on the set of Lassie, where he's guest starring as a deputy sheriff. Former Different Strokes producer Al Burton hired Bridges for the role.
It's great to know you have some friends who still care about you and are willing to help you out when you need it.
And that's it for us. New questions are now being raised about the 1969 death of Rolling Stones star Brian Jones. We'll have that inside story for you tomorrow.
And as we say goodbye for this Wednesday, our thoughts and, of course, best wishes go to Mary Wells and her courageous battle. Here is her super hit of the 60s, My Guy.
We'll see you. Enjoy.
This is Doug White. The three Democrats running for governor of Rhode Island have plenty to say about the issues and about each other. They'll face off this evening right here on Channel 10, beginning at 8 o'clock. Be sure to join us for the debate and for analysis tonight on the 11 o'clock News Watch.